Welcome. We're so glad you're here and thrilled. Listen, you guys are the smart ones. You came, I don't know if you saw it first service, but we had another bus here. There was nowhere to sit. We had people standing literally. So you guys can lay down if you want to, all right? Make yourself at home. But we're so glad you're here. For those of you that signed up, I just want to remind you, we're having our luncheon afterwards. This is for those that want to serve as greeter or ushers and those kind of things. So anyway, look forward. Just want to remind you that'll be after the service. And also, too, I want to introduce you to someone. This is Mr. Jeff. Say hello to Jeff Jansen. Say hi. Jeff is a photographer, and he's going to be taking some pictures. So if you see him moving around, pay no attention. But we're getting ready for a new website and those kind of things. If you go to a website, you can just tell when they're stock photos, can't you? You know, they're going, you know, and it's like, it's not them. We want real people in ours. So anyway, so if you're in a witness protection kind of program, you know, just tell us and we'll blur your face, okay? So anyway, but that's what's happening. But we're so glad you're here. Inside your program is a connection card. And if you take a moment to fill it out, if you're a first-time guest, please do that. And you can put it in the offering basket when it comes by or the generosity boxes by the exits. Also, as our folks know here, man, if you have a prayer request of any kind, would love our prayer team to pray for you. Use the back of that card. You can write it out there. Also, if you have a change of address or anything, just use the connection card. It's the best way to communicate with us as a leadership. So glad you're here. If you would, let's stand up this time, say hello to someone, get to know the folks around you. Let me pray over our service, if you'd join me. Father, we bless you. Thank you so much. You love us. God, we're here just to celebrate you. God, regardless of the circumstances of our life, you deserve our attention and our devotion and our allegiance and our worship. So, God, we want to say, worthy are you. Nothing else comes close. So, Lord, enjoy our song, our prayers, our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you'll remain standing for the word of the Lord through music and praise. Let me hear my worshipers.
Clap your hands.
Where's all my praises this morning? I want everybody to put your hands in the air and give a hand clap for the Lord Jesus Christ.
One of God,
every praise, just let God be in your heart as we continue on with the God of wonders. And think about this next song. In your daily life, as we get ready for this, God is a wonder in your life. Not just when things go right. Sometimes we'll be praising God when everything goes right. We'll praise God when everything goes really wrong. And all of a sudden you're praying and you're looking for God through mercies of healing, through hurt, through things that went wrong. Look for God every day, every ounce, every bit of your energy. You should look for God, not just in the bad times, not just in the good times. I've seen people raise up, they got a brand new car, they all got financed, everything's great. They go, oh, praise mercy, I got the car. I've seen people, and you have, and everybody in this room has seen people in your life and had people in your life that have struggled with their health, loved ones that have moved on, people who struggle at this hour, this minute, not in this room. Pray for them. Pray for God's mercy in their life and in yours. He is worthy.
I will celebrate. celebrate how great the Lord is with this next song. Great are you, Lord.
You may be seated. This time we're going to be receiving our offering. So ushers, if you get ready and if you would get your gifts ready. You know, God, I know with the offering, this is where our faith gets real, huh? The rubber hits the road. And it's a way that we, in a very real way, show God that we trust Him. So for those of you that are part of the family, thank you so much for your faithfulness and just trusting the Lord in this. Join me in prayer. Father, thank you so much that you are our source. Man, we can trust you. Thank you, God, for showing us new ways of your faithfulness. And God, we are just grateful to be called your kids. Thank you for your attention in our lives, your sovereignty, and Lord, just your greatness. Lord, we submit to you. And Father, want to honor you with every part of our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. Let's thank our worship team. Thank you, thank you. Thank you. All right, guys, we're in a series called Rooted, and I think we're going to wrap it up next week. But what we're looking at is the idea that I want 2018 to be a good year. I mean, that's my personal prayer, and I believe the same for you. You know, I'm excited because it's a new season here at the church. But here's what I know. For many of us, we allow our circumstances to dictate how good a year it has or has not been. You know, don't we often define our years like, well, that's the year I graduated high school, or I got married, or we had kids, or, you know, some kind of big event that happens. For some of us, yeah, I was really sick that year, or we had that accident. And we allow the ups and downs of life to define a year. And I don't think that's what God really wants. I mean, though, I know there's a natural part of that, because I'm sure if someone said, no, what was the greatest year of your life? He probably said, well, after we got the ark finally built, woo, you know, I mean, it was great to go for that boat ride, perhaps. But I think that if we are intentional about prioritizing God throughout the year, it'll make a difference. And so what we've been looking at is the idea that God has a purpose for your life. He's got a story that he wants to happen. He wants to unveil and just allow it to happen. But we have to be mindful of it. We have to be seeking it. Then also, I think the second week, we looked at this idea that regardless of where God wants you to go or what he wants you to do, you will have setbacks. Like, stuff happens. And in those moments when we're in frustrations or times of discouragement, you know what's needed? We need to endure with joy. Not simply endure, like drag us across the line to the new year, but to endure, but yet with joy, because we know that God is sovereign. God has this. It's under control. It's okay. We can trust him. And then the ideas we looked at, I think last week, the verse from Colossians, how we have to have faith. And what Paul writes, he says, just as you needed faith to have a relationship with God, to have Jesus forgive you of your sin, you know, faith is important at the beginning of it. It's also important every day of it. And so we need to trust God. It's always this idea of trusting God, which means not to be trusting ourselves or our circumstances, because that's going to change. And the idea is that God is our source for everything we need. And we need to remember that, because here's what I know. If we get news about our jobs coming to an end, we're not, well, you might be pretty happy about it, but there is the aspect of it of, oh no, what am I going to do next? Because you weren't counting on this, right? And what we looked at was how we need to remember God is the source. So God is just using that company as the cup to pour out his resources, but never mistake the company for being your resource. God's just using them to bless you. It always comes down to God. I mean, here's the truth. Some of us are trusting in our 401k, right? Oh, God, please let it be there. But we have no idea what's going to happen. I mean, it's up and down, up and down. We know what's coming at some point. And here's what we need to remember. God is our source, not Edward James. I was going to say Sherwin Williams. I knew that wasn't right. All right. Edward Jones, Edward Johnson something. All right, those guys, or whoever. All right, so don't put your trust in them. It's in God. We got to see God as the source for that. So, and then, where are we now? Yes, okay. Allow God to fill your story. Work it out. Now, here's what we're going to talk about today. I think today's one of the most important aspects of a Christian's life. We want to have fulfillment. We want to be peaceful and joyful, and we want God to be at work in our life. I believe what we're talking about today is, in some ways, a secret ingredient or a missing ingredient in many lives of people in the church. We're talking about living the Spirit-filled life. Here's why this is so important. Man, many of us, you know, we come to Christ and we just think, well, okay, now I got to go to church and now I got to read my Bible. And we sort of have this rules of things that, you know, God people do or church people do. And we begin to develop a system. And it's not about a system. It's about a Savior. Always remember that. It's always about a Savior. And so we're going to see today, God didn't, when he came and he rescued us when we gave our life, we finally figured out, I don't like doing life the way I'm doing. I have changed my mind about that. God, I want you and what you have for my life. God doesn't just say, fantastic, you finally figured it out. Now let me give you a new set of rules. Instead, he forgives us. Gave us a Savior, but he gives us the Holy Spirit. And it's the Holy Spirit in our lives that makes a difference. Now, I know depending on what your background is, some people are a little freaked out about that and what does that mean? And because let's face it, there are some people who are a little odd for God, right? And they sometimes blame the Holy Spirit. You're going, no, it's not the Holy Spirit. It's something else, okay? But what's important is understand that God, what we're looking at, God's given us the gift of the Holy Spirit, and that's what changes everything in our life. So let's go through this. There's a couple of points here just to sort of make sure we're on the same page, because I want to talk about how do we live a Spirit-filled life. First thing we got to remember is that the Holy Spirit is a he, not an it. He's a he, a being, not an it, not a force. He's a being. I get this from John 14:6, where Jesus says, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. Helper is not a thing. It's a role, but it's a person. It's a being. And it's important to remember that. Again, he's not an it. And I had one young pastor say that. He's just like, well, it referred to the Holy Spirit as an it. And I'm like, I just wanted to grab him by the neck because that's so doctrinally wrong. You got no business preaching or teaching that. Because, guys, it's all about a relationship. And here's why this is important. Again, some of you are going, duh, I get it. I know it's super, I mean, we're past that. But for many people, they don't. They're not there yet. And I just want to emphasize, it's always about relationship. Because if the Holy Spirit's a being, it's about cultivating a relationship, not trying to possess a power or a force in your life. You get it? It's about cultivating a relationship with the Holy Spirit, not trying to possess or corral him in so that you have a power in your life. It's not it. Second point I want to point out is that the Holy Spirit is the third member of the Godhead, the triune Godhead, which is a really fancy word for Trinity, okay? Trinity is a unique Christian doctrine. And let me show you where we get this from. It's the same verse, John 14:16. Now, if you had your Bible, those words are probably being read. So that means Jesus is speaking this. So it's Jesus, and he's going to talk about two other fellas, all right? I will ask the Father, right? That's two people there. And he will give you another helper, the third, to be with you forever. Now, we know that that's literally, it's talking about the Holy Spirit. So this is a great verse that is referencing the Trinity. You may have some friends say, well, that's not even in the Bible. The word Trinity is not, but the concept is there. And it's the idea that this is God we're talking about. The Holy Spirit is God. Now, here's what I love about this. This is a key verse in the development of understanding what it means. See the word another? That's simple in English, but it's like huge in its relevancy to it, because in the Greek language is very precise. That's why it was just brilliant timing, and I believe why God had Jesus come when he did, because the Greek was the language for the world. Okay, here's what I mean. Let's say, for example, I just gave you an orange, and you're going, oh, I love Florida oranges. Yum, 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 yum. You ate it, and then you say, can I have another? I would say, well, you know, maybe I'm out of oranges. But if I had an apple or some other piece of fruit, I would say, well, I don't have an orange, but how about this? Would this work? You might go, yeah, that'd be great. Because, again, they're similar, but they're not, right? That's why we don't compare apples to oranges. Good. Okay, yeah, yeah. So they're the same, but they're not the same. But for the purpose, if you had an orange, you might be pretty excited to eat an apple. Now, if I said, well, how about catfish? You might go, no, not after an orange. No, 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 all right? Because that just doesn't go. Apples and oranges, they can go together because it's another, but it's another of a different kind. It's fruit, but it's a different kind of fruit. So it's another of a different kind. However, if I gave you an orange and you loved it and you said, can I have another? I said, oh, yeah, here's another orange. That would be another of the same kind. Now, that second orange is not the exact as the first orange, because the first orange is in your digestive tract. We're not pulling that out, right? We can't give that back to you. But we're giving you another orange, so it's another of the same kind. This is the word that the Scripture uses to describe the Holy Spirit. When Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit, he's saying, I'll give you another of the same kind. And the emphasis here is that he's equal, different, but equal. And it's the concept where there's one God, but there's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And there is no illustration on earth that fully captures what this, you know, the truth of it, because it's just beyond. Every illustration will fall short at some point. But it's this one God, but three expressions or three personalities of the one God. And what Jesus is doing here is he is affirming the deity of the Holy Spirit. And so here's where this matters. Though they're the same, they're each unique as a person. They're unique in their function, right? Who died for our sins? Pop quiz. Who died for our sins? Very good. Very good, class. Very good. Okay. It wasn't God the Father, because we know Jesus was here on earth, and he claimed to be equal with the Father, all right? So that's we know that. But it wasn't God the Father. Jesus was talking to God the Father throughout his whole life. Okay, now this is, that was another of the same kind. Again, Jesus had the unique role of dying for our sins. Now Jesus is saying, here's another of the same kind. But the Holy Spirit has a unique role, again, not dying for our sin, but yet a unique role and function in our life. Now, we'll move on. The Holy Spirit, number three, permanently lives inside every believer. I get this from 1 Corinthians 3:16. Paul writes, do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? Okay, now, put the definition here for the word dwell. Dwell is a key word. The verb, okeo, means to dwell, to put roots down, like you're staying, you're not passing through. Now, the noun version of that very same word means a house, basically. It's where you live. Now, if it meant hotel, okay, then, okay, that'd be a totally different thing. But it means house. And this idea that the Holy Spirit dwells in us. He doesn't just stop by, give you a high five occasionally, make a visit around Christmas, and then go back. He dwells in us. And it's establishing the idea of permanency in our life. Okay, so hold on to that. He dwells in you permanently. And then you don't have to worry about him leaving. And just as we're talking about putting our roots in God, think of it this way. The Holy Spirit is putting roots in you. Like he is rooted in you inside of permanency. And then Ephesians 1:13, another verse. It says, in him you also, when you heard the truth about the gospel of your salvation and believed in him, look at the result. You were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. And the idea here is that the word sealed means you had to have authority to do this action. No one can undo the action. And that's the concept here that Paul is saying. You're sealed with the Holy Spirit. No one can undo this action because God has established it. Nothing can undo it. Okay? So what does the Holy Spirit do? He's in our life. What does he do? We got a list of it. And I'm just trying to, I'm giving you snapshots because there's so much here. We could do 8 weeks on this and it'd be a blast. But here's what he does. Number one, he convicts us of our sin. Have you ever, you know what conviction is, right? Someone saying something or you see something and you just go, oh, dang it. And you know, you guys got that gut feeling inside. And that doesn't even have to happen by some preacher yelling at you at church, does it? You can be sitting at a bus stop or somewhere and you see a bird and God will bring something to mind and you go, oh, man, and you're reminded of something. And it's the Holy Spirit poking at you going, you shouldn't have done that. Let's go fix this, right? So he convicts us of our sin. Secondly, he illuminates truth. This is why you can read the Bible and maybe you see a verse you perhaps have read many, many times, but then you're reading, oh my gosh, I never saw it before. Or there's a new aspect of it just seems to come to life. It's illuminated. Again, that's what the Holy Spirit does. Also, too, the Holy Spirit teaches us. He reminds us of the things of God. Look at the next one there. He guides us. I'm sorry. Yeah, reminds us of God's word. That's why it's so important, man. Spend time in God's word. And especially if you memorize scripture, man, God will bring that. The Holy Spirit will bring it back to mind at just the right time. He will guide us, letting us know where to go, left, right, her, him, what city. He assures us that we're children of God because when we mess up and we feel guilty and shame and all that, you know, the Holy Spirit's there to remind us that we're God's kids. Also, the Holy Spirit intercedes for us. He prays for us, it says. He directs us and warns us. You know, and because it's about a relationship and not about rules, guys, God will be so real if we're paying attention to where he will tell us, don't go, don't take a step further. Like, he will be specific in that way. But we got to be listening. That's the dynamic of the Holy Spirit in our life. He directs us. He'll warn us. I'm sure we all got stories by it. I do. But that's what he does. He directs us. So those are the things he wants to do in our life. And so, Holy Spirit's God, and he dwells in us. All right? Are we good with that? Do this. All right, good. He's God. The Holy Spirit is God. And he dwells in us. He's yours. Now, what do we do with that? Number one, we got to pay attention to life. I love this verse, this passage from Ephesians. It says, pay careful attention, then how you walk. Not as wise, but unwise. The phrase, how you walk, is a metaphor for how you do life, day after day, moment by moment. How you walk, pay attention. And then look what it says. Making the most of the time, because the days are evil. Here's why, this is really the primary passage for this series. I don't want to be on autopilot where we just get up, go to work, come home, eat, and do it again, right? That's the autopilot. And that's what this verse is saying is be careful, pay attention. Don't be thoughtless, but thoughtful of what you do and how you're living your life. Then where it says the days are evil, it means we live in a culture that is just going the wrong way. It naturally goes the wrong way, right? How many of you, you've seen kids, right? Have you seen two-year-olds say, no, mommy, right? Okay, one of these would be awesome. Yeah, kids, you don't need to teach them to be bad. It's just natural. As sweet as they are, at some point it's coming out, right? And so it's the way we are. And so what Paul is saying in this passage is, look, once we take our eyes off, we just sort of go on autopilot. We're not really being aware and intentional about our relationship with God, listening to God through his word and through the Holy Spirit. We'll just naturally gravitate away. And so he's saying, that's the way that this that is here. So make the most of the opportunities. Take advantage of every opportunity you have. Today's Sunday. You're in church. That's a great opportunity you've taken advantage of. Sunday afternoon, what's going to happen? There's no football. Is it the Pro Bowl today? No. It don't matter, does it? No. College football's over. That's the sad part, right? What does God want to do Sunday afternoon? Like, what is the opportunity? You know, you might think, well, I'm going to bed. I don't know what God wants, but I'm going to bed. What we want, God wants us to take, to be careful, pay attention of every opportunity. Then verse 17. So don't be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will for you is. And don't get, here's where it seems like, boom, Paul just takes a total left turn. Because he says, don't get drunk with wine, which leads to reckless actions, but be filled with the Spirit. And it seems sort of weird, doesn't it? Like out of the blue, you know, what does that have to do with anything? Let me tell you, because the key point there is be filled by the Holy Spirit. When you give your life to Christ, the Holy Spirit's yours. He dwells in you. It's a one-time event. You get him. But the command is be filled. You realize that's not anything you can do. If you're a cup, what's your job for me to pour grape juice into you? Nothing, right? You just be there. Now you can't fight against the grape juice or whatever I'm pouring in you. But you gotta just stop, surrender, and be still. That's the call to be filled with the Spirit. See, I believe that you're baptized with the Holy Spirit. It's a one-time event. Now, God'll do different things in your life. I absolutely believe that. But the call for us is to be filled. We're to make sure that we're under the control. See, just as wine, okay, if you're going to drink some alcohol, all right, okay, you voluntarily choose to pick it up and drink it. I mean, unless you're drugged, and that's a whole other scenario, I'm not going there. But the idea that you choose to pick it up and drink it. Well, at some point, you continue to do that, you're under the influence of the alcohol. In the same way, guys, we have to make sure that the greatest influence in our life is God, is the Holy Spirit. And the way we do that is we got to surrender to him. See, God's given us the command to be filled by the Spirit. And what that means is it's simply we're in the place where nothing else is a greater influence in our life. Have you ever had car fever before? You know, like you're getting a new car, you can't wait. You know it's time, and you're looking, and man, before the internet, remember, you'd have to go to the dealership and get the brochures and bring them home, and you know, you'd have brochures from all the different dealers and looking at all the different cars, and man, car fever's dangerous. Dangerous, right? Because we just start to want, and you know, we can sort of put together. First, we're content. We're going, well, we'll just get the base model, you know, because it's a cool car, but I don't need all those stuff. Until you begin looking at all the cool stuff, you're going, oh, I got to have that. I got to have it. I can't help it. And so this, you know, $20,000 car is now a $70,000 vehicle. You know, it's so easy because we see the stuff and we're enticed by it. And for you, maybe you're going, God, that's the dumbest analogy. Well, let's talk about clothes then. Maybe that's your thing, clothes or whatever. We all have a thing that can be so distracting and can capture our attention. And for some of us, now hang on, pull your feet back, so I'm stepping on them. It's Facebook. You're on it all the time. And we all have a thing that can just capture our attention. And we just, you know, we're there, we're in it. Netflix, there you go. We all have a thing. Right, it can be good things too. It can be working out. Man, I've done that before. That became my Lord, and man, it's nothing fits on the throne of our heart other than Jesus, the Holy Spirit. That's his seat. And whenever we allow anything else to take that, we'll be frustrated. You may have success in some areas. You know, if you just put the job there or the vocation and you're just going after it, trying to build a business or build a career or whatever, you know, sure, maybe your bank account goes up, but you're out of balance. Something is not right. Not if you put that on the throne. You know, and the joy of being Spirit-filled, when we put the Holy Spirit in that place where we give him our attention, our allegiance, and we make sure there's no other voice. We're not looking at the Sunday papers or, again, whatever else could be our distraction. We make sure that nothing has our attention other than God. Oh, my gosh, it's so much better. Life is better, and you're better at life. And that's where we begin to experience joy, peace, and all those things. So here's the question. We've all messed up at that, right? None of us have been perfect at that. So what happens? There's a couple of verses here. Let's see the next slide, I think it is. This is where it talks about how we can grieve the Holy Spirit and quench the Holy Spirit. Did you know that? These are two things. We can stop God at work in our life. Quench literally means to suppress a fire. Put a fire out, right? And isn't that ironic that that is the very symbol of Acts 2? The picture, the symbolism of the Holy Spirit is a fire. The passion in us. And we can put that fire out. And this is whenever we try to put God in a box. We say, no, God won't do that. God can't do that. I've never seen it that way. For some of us, the Holy Spirit will prompt us. He'll say, go talk to that person. Go to their house. He'll call us to do something. You know what we do? We quench it. We go, no, I could never do that. I'd be embarrassed. I wouldn't know what to say. It'd be weird if I just showed up. You know, and we can go back and forth and we fight it. When we do that, if God's asking you to go talk to someone about Jesus, go to their house and bless them. It's probably Jesus doing it because it's not the devil, okay? Satan's not going to tell you go witness or go share a kind word with someone. It's not how he operates. So you got to go with it. Go. And if not, we quench it. We're like, no, I can't do that. That wouldn't be right. Again, I would be embarrassed. I'm shy. I'm an introvert. Whatever. We quench it. And many of us, we've been quenching and quenching and stopping out that fire for so long. We begin to wonder, man, is God even there? That's why I can sit through church and not even be happy. Right? Because fire's gone. And I don't think it's God's will. It's quenched. Now, there's also the idea that we can grieve. Now, I love that word because it tells us quenching or to grieve someone means it's not a thing. It's a person or a being. If I had the orange, you can't grieve an orange, right? It's just an orange. But we can grieve each other. And again, another picture of how the Holy Spirit's a person. It's a being. And we grieve the Holy Spirit whenever we do things we shouldn't be doing. You know, we go out in this passage here in Ephesians 4, the end of 4 and the first part of 5, there's a big list here. And Paul is what he's saying. He's not jumping on the church trying to make them feel bad. What he's telling them is saying these kind of, he gives a list here. He says, these behaviors are not consistent with who you are. Like when you're in Christ, you have a whole new identity. You're righteous. You're holy. You're a saint. You know, you are not supposed to live like this. And he talks about being bitter, being unforgivable, not forgive someone, to steal, to cheat, you know, all those kind of things. No sexual immorality. He says these kind of behaviors and activities are inconsistent with those who are in Christ. So he's saying, don't do it because that's how you should be living. And when we do that, it grieves the Holy Spirit. God doesn't want us to live like that. It hurts him. It grieves him. And what I know, based on my life, you know, when we grieve him and we grieve him and grieve him, we're hurting him. And we feel like God's moved away. We feel all alone. And it's as, I mean, we feel like we're so disconnected, or else we're just so ignorant and blissful. But the Holy Spirit's good enough to allow us to feel that separation. And it's not because God moved. It's because we moved. We moved with our choices away. Now, here's what I want to say to you, especially if you're an older generation, and I'm part of it, I think, because here's what I know. If you've grown up, you soon learn that, you know what, there are good things to do and there are bad things we shouldn't do, right? And I need to order my life. I need to do the right things because it's just the right thing to do. So we follow, many of us follow our head. And so we think, well, I shouldn't steal, right? Because stealing's bad. It's just not right. And I say that older generation because let's go back a few years when even those who didn't go to church, they still knew stealing was wrong. Nowadays, stealing's fine. You ask people, and they're like, sure, it's fine, as long as you don't get caught. Or what's the motive? I mean, everything is relative, right? There's no absolute truth. It's relative. You know, is it okay to lie? Well, sure, if it doesn't hurt their feelings, or if it gets me what I want. It rationalizes, well, is something right? Well, it depends on what's the result. Whereas older generation, we think, no, it's always right regardless of the result. And here's where a lot of church people get stuck. They have a devotion to a system or a set of rules instead of a devotion to the Lord or to the Savior, right? And so we think, I'm fine because I go to church, I read my Bible, and we have this set of rules that we follow through. We think, I'm good. But God's going, no, it's relationship. So don't get hung up on the rules. It's all about cultivating a relationship. And in this context, we're talking about the Holy Spirit. We need to spend time with God through the Holy Spirit. Here's a solution. We'll wrap it up here. Because if I was to ask you, well, what should you do if you've grieved the Holy Spirit? If you've quenched the Holy Spirit's work in your life? Some people would say, well, I just need to rededicate my life. No, you don't. You know why? You're horrible at rededications. All right? So am I. We're bad at that. Should we make a commitment? No, because we're horrible at it. But what we need to do is we need to repent. And then here's the key word in this next verse from John 15. Again, Jesus speaking. He says, I'm the vine. Jesus is the vine. You, us, are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, it is he that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. He wants us to abide. The way we abide is when we're like completely surrendered to him. We don't let anything else have our attention. It's him, it's him, it's him. You know, if you know anything about water safety, if you're a lifeguard, one of the first things they teach you is if there's someone drowning, get out there, but you stay away from them. You know that? Because they're like doing all of this, right? And if you get close enough, they'll grab your head or anything they can grab, and guess what? You're going under. Because this person still thinks they can save themselves. And so they're desperate and just flailing and wailing. So what they teach them is stay away, let them go under. Give them a second or two, again, not too much, right? But the whole point is get them to stop fighting. Then you go get them. They have to be in a state where they're completely surrendered, where they're not working against you. Guys, that's where God wants us to be, where we're completely surrendered to him. Because when we think we can fix this, well, I'll just put a new plan together. I'll get more committed. I'll be more disciplined. I'll get up early. You know, when we sort of put our plan together without saying, God, what do you want? We're doing this. We're doing whatever we can. I've seen people like that. Now, the good news is God will often take us to places where we're doing that because he wants us to come to an end of ourselves, to where we finally come to the conclusion, I can't do it. And God goes, perfect. Now we're ready to get somewhere. It's what he wants. The secret to living the Spirit-filled life is surrender and trust. We got to spend time with God through the Holy Spirit. You know, guys, here's what I know. If you're trying and striving on your own, you're going to be frustrated. And it's very tiring. I hate talking to church people who are just so tired because they do too much. I got a great solution. Stop. Henry Cloud, who's a great Christian psychologist, you know what he says? He loves it. I love it. He says, you know what? No is a complete sentence. Some of us got to say no. Stop, because we're allowing stuff, either activity, good or bad, or relationships that are taking the place of our allegiance to the Holy Spirit. And it becomes not good. Because it's only in Christ that we'll be fulfilled. We'll actually feel, you can be without a job and be peaceful. I know. You get what seems to be at the end of your rope, and I promise you, you know, you can have joy even there where you don't know what's going to happen next. You can still have that, because that's what the Holy Spirit wants to do in us. Fill us with those things and then lead us into exactly where God wants us to be. I pray, man, my prayer every day is, Holy Spirit, I can't, but you can. Fill me for the work that you've called me to do. Man, make that part of your daily prayer life. If you'll, let's bow your heads, please. Hey, I want to give each of us the opportunity. You know, here's the truth. All of us, we've messed up. We are far from God at some point. And Jesus died for your sins. And he's saying, I want a relationship with you. I love you so much. I died for the punishment that you deserve. But we have to say yes. We have to be in a place where we surrender, where we turn our back on what we used to do and say, God, I want a different life. I have changed my mind. I no longer want to live that way. And when we embrace Jesus, again, by faith, we trust that Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the world only because the Bible says so. Then you know what? That's the beginning. The spiritual life has begun. The Holy Spirit is in us, deposited. We have him. Now the secret for living the Christian life, the fullness of life, is to be surrendered by faith to the Holy Spirit. Let's do that now, because this is a command from the passage from Ephesians. Be filled. So let's do it. Let's say, God, I don't want anything else to have my attention or my allegiance. I want you to be on the throne of my life. I repent. I don't want any relationship to be number one. I don't want any substance to be number one. I don't want any activity to be number one. I don't want any selfishness, bitterness, or any kind of thing inside of me to lead the charge here. Holy Spirit, sit on the throne of my life. God, I surrender it to you. Fill me with your Spirit. Fill me with your Spirit that I may walk, live, and be a person of joy, peace, and love in all circumstances, in all things, to all people. Father, do this for your sake. Amen. Amen. Hey, if you have any questions, man, shoot me an email. Fill out the connection card or something. Let's dialogue. Because I believe, man, the more we surrender to the Holy Spirit, the more that God wants to do and will be able to do in us. So seek him this week. Join us for our last song.
Thank you, Dr. Iskra. If you guys would all stand with us, and we'll sing our last song this morning. It's called All My Fountains. Now, I think it's supposed to rain this afternoon, so if that does happen, you can remember that rain and help you remember this song. So it talks a lot about water. I was in a dry and desert land last week myself. I was in Colorado, and this is a song that speaks to me from that perspective. So we want you to join us. Clap your hands with us a little bit if you can. We hope you have a great week. We'll sing this last song. Words are up on the screen.
This dry and desert land, I tell myself, keep walking on. There's something up ahead, water falling like a song. An everlasting stream, your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow. All my fountains.
A flood for my soul.
A flood for my soul. A well that never will run dry. I've rambled on my own, never believing I would find an everlasting stream. Your river carries me home. Let it flow.
See you here for the usher and greeter lunch. We'll see you in the fellowship hall. But thanks for coming, guys. See you next week.